Okay, section 3.3 is finally we're getting into the derivative shortcuts. We'll no longer be looking at the difference quotient to calculate derivatives. Now we're going to come up with some shortcuts we can use for figuring out derivatives. I want to point out something before we begin. The calculus was sort of developed at around the same time by two different people. Newton, he used this notation for derivatives. We've talked about it before. And so if Newton wanted to take a derivative, he would call it f prime of x. If he wanted to take another derivative, he would take f double prime of x. So he just would add tick marks. Then there was, at the same time, a guy named Leibniz who was inventing calculus at the same time as Newton, or discovering calculus. And his notation was based on more on the slope formula, so it's kind of easier to see that what he was doing was he was calculating slope. So he talked about dy dx. So when he was talking about derivative, he would call it dy dx. It's kind of reminiscent of delta y over delta x, which is how we talk about the slope formula. So we subtract the y-coordinates, subtract the x-coordinates. But for Leibniz, this changing the delta sign to a d made the change into a tiny little change. So he would talk about dy over dx as the first derivative. We'll get into it a little bit later how Leibniz did second derivative notation, but I'll show you a preview. He would say he's going to take a derivative of, so he would take the derivative of dy dx, and the way he wrote that was the second derivative of y. So he used, they look like exponents, but that indicates that he's taking a second derivative, not that he's raising anything to a power. I wanted to preview both of those notations because I think they both come up in this presentation. All right, so here's your very first shortcut. And the shortcut is anytime you're taking the derivative of a constant, the derivative is zero. And that kind of makes sense if you think about what the graph of a constant function looks like. It's a horizontal line. So if you have y equals 12, that would be a horizontal line of 12. And the slope of that horizontal line at any x-coordinate would be zero. So some examples, f of x equals 100, so f prime of x would be zero. F of x equals pi squared, well, pi is a constant, so pi squared is a constant, so the derivative of that would also be zero. All right, there's your very first shortcut. Shouldn't seem shocking. Okay. The second shortcut is really quite powerful. The second shortcut is called the power rule, and it says that if you have x to the exponent, then the derivative of that would be the exponent times x raised to a power reduced by 1. So the only key for the power rule, it's really easy to use, but the only key is to make sure that you have your function written in the form x to the m before you use the shortcut. So if I'm taking the derivative of x, that's the same thing as x to the 1 power. So the derivative of that would be 1 times x to the 0 power, which is just 1. That also makes sense if I think of this as the slope of the straight line, 1 times x, that slope would be 1. So the derivative would be 1. This one, before I take the derivative, I'm going to rewrite it as x to the negative 6 power, because remember, exponents that are negative go to the other part of the fraction. And so if I take a derivative of x to the negative 6 power, I'm going to get negative 6x to the negative 7 power, which, if I rewrite that with exponents, would be negative 6 over x to the 7th power. It turns out that the power rule even works with fractional exponents, so if I have f of x equals square root of x, I could rewrite that as x to the 1 half power, and we've actually found this derivative a couple of different ways with the difference quotient, but you can see that if you use this shortcut, it's just a lot faster to get to the point of 1 half x to the negative 1 half power, which if we rewrote it would be 1 over 2 1/2 power means square root, negative means in the denominator, so 1 over 2 root x. Notice that you have to be kind of comfortable with exponent rules in order to use this shortcut, and I hope that you have some comfort with exponents. Shortcut number 3 says if you have a constant times a function and you take a derivative, then the derivative will be the constant times the derivative of the function. So for example, if I have 8 times x to the third, the derivative of that would be 8 times 3x squared, using the power rule, and so that would be 24x squared. People often ask me, do you have to show that step? No, you don't have to show that step. I just showed it so you could see where that came from. So this looks like a this looks like division, but we could rewrite it as 1/2 x squared. So as I take the derivative of that, it would be 1/2 times 2, bring down the exponent, so 1/2 times 2 x to the 1 power, or just x. Okay, the next shortcut is why it's so easy to take derivatives of polynomials. If you have a sum or a difference of two functions and you take the derivative, it will just be the sum or the difference of the derivatives. So for this function, it's a polynomial. That just means I get to take the derivative of each piece using the power rule. So I'm going to get f prime of x equals 8x to the third minus 16x plus 0. And that's the derivative of the constant is 0. The sum and difference rule is totally straightforward. You look at it and you're like, oh, great, I just get to take the derivative, and so that means I get to take the derivative and add them together, that's great. It turns out that the product rule, we wish it were that straightforward. So we wish that we could take this derivative and say, well, I'm just going to take the derivative of this red part and get 1 plus 8x, and then I'm going to take the derivative of this blue part and get 6x squared minus 0, and that's my derivative. It turns out that's not true. So there is a product rule that we can use, but we can't just take the derivatives and multiply them together. So this is the product rule. It's kind of complicated, but if you have a product of two things, and here's that Leibniz notation again, we're taking the derivative of a product of two things, what you get is you get the derivative of the first thing times the second thing left alone, plus the derivative of the second thing times the first thing left alone. You can do it, of course, because it's addition and it's multiplication. You can change the order of these terms, or you could even change the order of the sum. So we'll practice that. So in order to practice that, I'm going to take the derivative. I'm going to use color to kind of help. So I'm going to take the derivative So I'm going to take the derivative of 2x cubed, so I have 6x squared minus 4, and then I'm going to have the second thing left alone. X squared minus 9, and then plus derivative of the first thing. First thing left alone, so 2x cubed minus 4x, and then the derivative of x squared minus 9. Now, if I were trying to find the function for this derivative, probably the best thing to do would be to FOIL this out and distribute this and add like terms. But if I'm evaluating it at x equals 3, then I'd recommend plugging the 3 in at this point. So plugging the 3 in at this point, I have 6 times 9, which is 54 minus 4, which is 50, times 9 minus 9, which is 0. And then 2 times 27, minus 12 times 2 times 3, which is 6. I don't even have to worry about that part. So I have 54 minus 12 times 6. So I have 42 times 6. 252. Pretty steep. Just keeping in mind that we could do the product rule. I'm gonna leave this one for another video if you would like to see more detail, but that would be a product rule example. The quotient rule is very complicated when you first look at it. It comes with a poem, which I still say to this day almost every time I use the quotient rule. The reason that the poem is useful is because it helps me remember which order to subtract in. If I subtract in the wrong order, my answer would have the wrong sign. So here's the poem. It's kind of silly, but I do say it to myself every time I use the quotient rule. It's low d high, so d means take the derivative, so the low is the denominator, times the derivative of the high, minus high d low, all over the square of what's below. And away we go. So the reason for the poem is to remember which order to subtract and remember all of the details of that formula. So here's an example. I want to find f prime of 3. So let's go through it. So we're going to find f prime. So it's going to be low x plus 4 d high, so 2x, minus high x squared minus 9 d low, all over the square of what's below. Now I'd really strongly recommend that you plug in the 3 right now rather than try to simplify. So f prime of 3 would be 7 times 6 minus 0 all over 49. So it would be 6 over 7. This one actually says, write the equation for the tangent to f at x equals 2. So here's another example of the quotient rule. So it's going to be low d high minus high d low all over the square of what's below. Again, I really strongly recommend plugging in your number as soon as you take that derivative, because we have a number to go with. So we have 3 times 4 minus 4 plus 3 is 7, all over 3 squared is 9. So it's 5 ninths is the slope. And then f of 2 would be 4 plus 3 is 7 over 3. So then the equation for the tangent line would be y equals 5 ninths times x minus 2 plus 7 thirds. Okay. As we're taking higher order derivatives, so I kind of talked about this a little bit in the beginning, Newton's notation would be just add more tick marks. And Leibniz notation would be those little things that look like exponents, but they really mean take the second derivative. For Newton, if he kept taking derivatives, he'd keep adding tick marks until he gets to 4 of them, and that kind of starts looking messy. So he would actually put, it also looks like an exponent, he would put the number of derivatives in parentheses. Leibniz just keeps using those things that look like exponents to indicate higher order derivatives. I'm going to stop there, partly because I'm only allowed a 15-minute video on YouTube.